Hello everyone, this is Dennis and you are on the Den Electro channel. Today we will continue the topic of creating power supplies based on the CR6850 chip. In the last video I showed how you can use it to make a 20 watt power supply, with an output voltage of 5 volts and a current of 4 amps. Today I will show you how to make a more improved version with a voltage of 12 volts and a power of 60 watts. The creation process will be exactly the same as in the previous video, but with some changes. I will now tell you about them in detail. The diagram looks like this. It is almost the same as in the previous version, where I made a 5-volt power supply. But here we had to make some changes. The first change, of course, affected the transformer. Here I took a larger core. The primary winding here also consists of two half windings. The first has 33 turns, the second 30. The secondary winding contains 6 turns, and the power winding of the microcircuit contains 8 turns. I left the numbering of the ends of the windings exactly the same. They are also marked on the board. After the diode bridge on the mains voltage rectifier, I added another capacitor in parallel with the existing ones. Now there are two capacitors, C3 for 33 microfarads and C4 for 10 microfarads. For a power supply of such power, the capacitor capacity must be set to at least 60 microfarads. I didn't have this in my supplies, so I installed others. If you have a larger capacitor, it is advisable to install them. I also added another capacitor to the filter and secondary winding. There are now two of them between the diode assembly and the inductor. C8 and C9 are both capacitors of 1000 microfarads and 25 volts. I added it there not because there's not enough capacity, but because one capacitor gets very hot at such power, and this way the load of the power supply is divided into two capacitors, and it is easier for them to work. And of course, in order for the power supply to produce 12 volts, it is necessary to change the wiring of the TL431 microcircuit. I set R10 to 18 kilo ohms and R11 to 4.7 kilo ohms. Also, in parallel with R11, I added a resistance of R14 at 100 kilo ohms. It's not necessary, but the problem is that without it, the power supply produces a voltage of just under 12 volts. This is because my resistances, although listed as 18 kilo ohms and 4.7 kilo ohms, actually have slight deviations. If you find reference resistances and you have exactly 12 volts at the output of the power supply, then resistance R14 can be omitted. Also, no one forbids you to install trimmers instead of permanent resistors. Resistor R6 should be set to 0.95 ohms or a little less. It is needed for the power supply to trigger power limiting protection. To get a resistor of such low resistance, I soldered two resistances in parallel, on the first and on the third. The problem here is that such low resistances are very difficult to measure with a multimeter. Therefore, you have to select a resistor almost by eye. If the resistance of R6 is greater than 0.95 ohm, then the power supply will not produce maximum power. This completes all the main changes in the circuit. Now you can start troubleshooting the transformer. For the transformer, I will use this core. You can see its dimensions on your screens. The power supply operates in single cycle mode, so the core must have a gap. The transformer frame looks like this. It has four legs. your core may be exactly the same dimensions, but have a different frame. In principle, this is not important. The most important thing is that the dimensions of the core match. First, we will wind half of the primary winding. We start winding from the left leg, make 33 turns, and wind the wire onto the right leg, but do not bite it off. I use a wire with a diameter of approximately 0.2 millimeters. I took it from the winding of a Soviet TV picture tube. Then two or three layers of insulation. Then we turn the frame the other way. Here we will wind the secondary winding. Starting from the left leg, we wind 6 turns. I will use a 4-core wire. The diameter of each core is 0.5 millimeters. In the diagram, these pins are marked with numbers 5 and 6. Then we do 2 or 3 layers of insulation again. We turn the frame back to the side where we wound half of the primary winding. Now we will wind the power winding of the microcircuit. It has 8 turns. When conducting, I will use the same one that I used for the primary winding, although the cross-section here can be taken smaller, since the supply current of the microcircuit is not very large. We start winding from the upper left wire. We turn it to the right and make 8 turns. We apply the end of the winding to the right side and bring it up. We place both ends of the winding in the slots that are available in the frame. These ends are marked 3 and 4. Then we again make 2 or 3 layers of insulation. We remove the end of the primary winding from the right leg. And no further, we wind another 30 turns in the same direction. This will be the second half of the primary winding. We wrap the end of the winding around the right leg and bite it off. These ends are marked on the diagram with numbers 2 and 1. Now all the windings of the transformer are ready. On top of all the windings, you can add a few more layers of insulation. This is not a mandatory procedure. But if your turns are not wound very tightly, then during the operation of the transformer they may hum. The tape will help tighten them more securely, and the transformer will make less sound. Then we insert the core into the frame. We either glue its halves together or fasten them tightly with tape so that they do not hum. Please note that the ends of the secondary winding are very thick, and the legs of the frame are thin. I'll explain what to do with this a little later. The inductance of the primary winding was 1.46 millihenry or 1460 microhenry. As usual, I make the board for the power supply from cardboard. I glue the location of all the elements on top and the wiring on the bottom. The payment is collected very easily. The main thing is not to rush. Be careful and insert the parts into the places allocated for them. Holes must be made in the places marked with dots. The legs of the parts will be inserted there. You also need to make 3 jumpers on the board. They are now shown in red. The numbers mark those holes where the ends of the windings are inserted. The transformer will be installed on the board like this. Its legs will coincide with the numbers 5 and 6. For thick wires of the secondary winding, large through holes will need to be made nearby. I haven't noted them here, but in the version of the board that I'm linking to in the description, they will be there. The primary side will also be inserted into holes 1 and 2. The power winding of the chip will be inserted into holes 3 and 4. In addition to the transformer, you need to wind inductor L2. I will make it on a dumbbell like this. Its inductance should be around 10 microhenry. To do this, I took the same wire that I used to wind the secondary winding of the transformer and made 8 or 9 turns. Only I fold it not into 4 cores, but into 3. Once the transformer is ready, the inductor is ready. You can insert them into the board. And behind them, install other parts of the power supply. By the way, this is what resistor R6 looks like. As I said earlier, I assembled it from 2 resistors soldered in parallel. On the other side, we connect all the parts with wires. The paths are located in the same way. In this version of the board, I soldered a 100 kilo ohm resistor in the upper left corner. In version number 2, the resistor will have its place. It will be located on the top right near the LED. We connect the power supply to the mains voltage. The red LED on the board lights up and the multimeter shows an output voltage of 12.3 volts. I'll show you what happens if a short circuit occurs at the output of the power supply. To do this, I will connect its wires through a multimeter in ammeter mode. As you can see, the light on the power supply has gone out and is blinking periodically. The power supply goes into protection and emits pulses at regular intervals, trying to start up. The power supply can remain in this state for an unlimited amount of time. The main thing is that there is good cooling of the transistor and diode assemblies. During testing, I attach 2 radiators. But here you can use 1 solid radiator since the housing of the diode assembly and transistor is plastic, and no short circuit can occur. As usual, I will use an electronic load to test power supplies. In one of the previous videos I showed how it can be assembled, the link will be in the upper right corner and in the description. As you can see, the power supply holds a current of 5 amperes perfectly. The voltage dropped by 0.2 volts. Output power 60 watts. If the load is increased further, the power limitation protection is triggered. The voltage sags, the current increases, but the maximum load of the power supply does not exceed the permissible limits. Under the video, I will leave a link to the file with the PCB layout. It opens in the Sprint Layout program. Please note that I made a border around the polygons. If you make the board on cardboard like I did, then after printing the top and bottom sides, you will need to cut off the frame. This way, all the holes will match and no shift will occur. As you can see, the creation process is similar to the previous 5-volt version. If there is something here that is not clear to you, I recommend that you familiarize yourself with that video. There I explained everything in detail. The link will be in the description. That's all for today. In order not to miss new videos, subscribe to my channel, click on the bell, leave a comment, Click on like and bye, everyone.